Trains and movies go together like avocados and hopper wagons, and the works of modern-day auteur Wes Anderson are no exception. In this video, we'll look at every instance Anderson has used trains in his films. If you're lazy or if you have a short attention span, here they are in 13 seconds. If you want to find out more, stick around and enjoy the video. Before we get started, I should warn you at this point that this video will contain spoilers for Anderson's work. I'll try to break it up clearly so you can skip the films you haven't yet watched. Number 1, Rushmore, 1998. As this YouTube video will end with a model train in a play in a film, and because I don't think the railway line in Bottle Rocket is worthy of inclusion in this list, I think it's rather nice to start with Rushmore, where in Serpico, which is one of the incredible school plays directed by Max Fisher, played by Jason Schwartzman, a large-scale model train is used to simulate the world outside the New York apartment shown on stage. Serpico was actually a very dark film starring Al Pacino, so it's one of those school plays where kids really shouldn't be doing it, which adds to the humour. The train actually looks to be bigger than gauge 1. Pullman carriages probably wouldn't be seen on an elevated railway, but I guess you've got to make do with what you can get. This is a nice precursor to Asteroid City, as we shall see later on. The Darjeeling Limited, 2007. Made nearly a decade after Rushmore, and an obvious inclusion in this list, being the title of the film, as well as the place the main characters spend the most time in the first half. Amazingly, this was mostly shot on location in a moving train. Filmed mostly on India's Northwestern Railway, which is a division of Indian Railways, 5'6" broad gauge line, NWR rented the film crew 10 coaches and a locomotive for the 3 months they needed to complete their scenes. The loco is a WDM 2A class, number 16675. I believe this has since been rebuilt into a WDM 3A class, as there are recent photos of it within the past couple of years. In the train, a lot of hand-painted items were used, not just the loco and carriages, but also items like the crockery and the dining car were hand-painted locally. The inside of the broad gauge carriages were modified so parts of the set could hinge or roll out of the way to make room for crew and equipment. The camera dolly track was even mounted to the ceiling of the corridor rather than on the floor. Mark Friedberg, the production designer, published these concept and behind the scenes images of the train, noting that the finished interior design was a fusion of Art Deco luxury trains in Europe and America with Indian practice. Art director Aradhana Seth took these photos of the painted outside of the train, just as it had been finished, which featured many tourist-oriented Indian motifs such as the elephant on the nose of the loco. Note also the eyes on the buffers. Indian Railways provided staff on board to keep track of other train movements. In some instances, the Darjeeling Limited had to be sidelined to allow other passenger services to pass by. When the train was delayed and had to stop, crew members rocked it to give the impression of movement so that filming could continue. On occasion, a spare railway carriage body was mounted onto a truck chassis to enable the team to get pickup shots without using the train itself. I think this is what's been used in the dream train sequence near the end of the film. The final train the brothers catch is a meter gauge one. Note the center buffer. Named the Bengal Lancer, which is another fictitious name train, in a fetching red livery to contrast with the Darjeeling Limited's blue. This is the train that plays out the end of the film as the credits roll. Fantastic Mr. Fox, 2009. This foray into stop motion animation is one of my favorites. It also deserves a place in this video, because a train plays a key role in an early scene in the film. Mr. Fox's son Ash feels very put out by his cousin Christofferson coming to stay, and makes him feel unwelcome. Christofferson is forced to sleep under Ash's train set, but noticing Christofferson is crying, Ash switches on the train and they share a quiet moment together. It doesn't heal their relationship, but it's a glimmer of hope that they'll one day be friends. What I really like is that Ash's toys are mimics of the ones in the world outside, and the train is exactly the same as the one that rumbles through the valley, including what I assume is a parcels coach painted a different colour to the rest. This is a really nice touch by the props department. The Grand Budapest Hotel, 2014. The titular hotel is accessed from Babelsberg town via a funicular. This was actually built in model form and functioned as part of the miniature set. During the course of the film, the Zigzag Division twice attempt to arrest Zero on their way from Babelsberg to Lutz. The border crossing has been closed and the train is forced to halt in a barley field. The exteriors for this train, I believe, were shot on the 750mm gauge Weißeritz Valley Railway on the outskirts of Dresden in Germany. It's near to the filming location in Görlitz. This three-arch bridge is Bormannsgrundbrücke, and the loco is a 2102 tank engine. Massive though these things are, The sleeper carriage is a work of fiction and existed only on the film set. In fact, half of it was just mounted on a camera dolly, using the bare minimum required to get the shot. When Jopling is pursuing Deputy Kovacs, the hapless deputy climbs aboard the Lutz Metro, a bright yellow tram. As with so many of the trains in this film, the tram is a prop, mounted aboard a lowrider truck chassis. It's very convincing though, especially when footage of Willem Dafoe riding along tram tracks is used too. Monsieur Gustav and Zero climb aboard a goods train in their escape from Checkpoint 19. This train is entirely made by the prop department, from the cowcatcher-equipped locomotive, to the cramped freight car, to the interior shot where it pulls into the station, which of course, like earlier, is just enough train interior to wrap around a camera dolly. A special mention should go to the animated cable cars in the Zubrovkian Alps, going to the observation point and the monastery on Gabelmeister's Peak. A full-size prop of the cable car was created, but the animated ones are 2.5D animation, essentially flat assets working in a 3D space. Come Together, a fashion picture in motion, directed by Wes Anderson for H&M's Christmas ad campaign in 2016, Come Together is almost a fusion of the claustrophobic environment of the Darjeeling Limited with the art and filming style of the Grand Budapest Hotel. Adrian Brody's conductor is aboard a representation of a luxury long-haul service across America in the deep midwinter. The train is delayed, meaning the passengers will miss Christmas morning, so it's up to conductor Ralph and his assistant Porter Fritz, played by director Garth Jennings, to serve up an impromptu Christmas brunch. The train is very much like others on this list, being somewhat larger than normal on the inside. We see in the introduction that most of the passengers are on a double-deck aluminium, or should I say aluminium, bodied sleeper car. The rear of the train is revealed to be a gorgeous 1950s-style observation saloon. A shout-out should go to conductor Ralph's ability to catch a mailbag with a billhook and a Christmas tree with his bare hands at what must be over 40 miles an hour, which just goes to show that experience and discipline pays off. Looks like there's a train within a train here, as the corridor floor is designed around rails for the camera dolly to sit on, an easier method than the roof-mounted track as seen in the Darjeeling Limited. It's a simple short film, but one that has a nice warm fuzzy feeling, and of course, it's 100% set on a train. Isle of Dogs, 2018. Of course, it wouldn't be a Hollywood film set in futuristic Japan without a Shinkansen-esque train, and the city of Megasaki is shown to have an elevated high-speed railway in the opening sequence. Bonus points for spotting the rail car in the background. Or is it a maglev? Special mention should also go to the numerous cable car systems that crisscross Megasaki and take refuse, and dogs, away to Trash Island. These appear to be a mix of foreground 3D and background 2D animation. Cable cars are not very futuristic in themselves, but do help to conjure up a vision of somewhere in between steam and cyberpunk theme-wise, sort of a retro-future kind of aesthetic. The cable car towers loom over Trash Island, and whilst they are a connection to the mainland, their height makes them a one-way connection, reinforcing the dog's exile. They do rely on a bit of movie magic as the towers have wheels on them, but the cars seem to be independently powered and capable of changing direction with their own wheels, so perhaps they're worthy of inclusion as a sort of cable monorail. It is shown that they have the cable equivalent of point work as the group gets separated this way partway through the film. Towards the end of the story, the cable cars, or trams as they are referred to, get repurposed into personnel transport, reflecting the dog's rehabilitation in the story and a happier ending for all. The French Dispatch, 2021. In another feast for the eyes, The French Dispatch is set in the city of Ennui-sur-Blaise. The art style is so similar to the Grand Budapest Hotel that you could imagine them inhabiting a shared universe, although the storytelling style is rather different. Ennui is big enough to justify a conventional railway as well as a metro system, which, just like the city, is at once charming, seedy and run down, being infested by rats. Owen Wilson takes a tumble in the metro during his introduction section, The Cycling Reporter, and the metro is a constant in the story set in Ennui-sur-Blaise. In real life, the movie was filmed in Angoulême, which, whilst it does have a substantial railway station, has no metro of its own. Stations crop up either as scenery or, in some instances, a handy way for characters to enter and exit the scene. In the fourth story, the criminal gang's hideout also has a metro station outside, with the elevated railways and trains of Ennui featuring in the rather wonderful graphic novel-style chase sequence, which puts me in mind of those of Tintin or Adèle Blanc-Sec. From a practical point of view, evidently the trains in this film are either mock-ups or cartoons, but I think they do help to pad out the fictional universe and hark back to the Paris of the mid to late 20th century. One of the cover pages of the French Dispatch even features a cartoon of Ennui citizens in the metro. The other blink-and-you'll-miss-it train in the film is in the second story, The Concrete Masterpiece, where Tony Revolori's artist character is hoboing on a goods train through the countryside. This is likely a set piece, and my guess would be the sunflower fields were achieved with green screen given the length of the shot. Asteroid City, 2023. On to Anderson's newest work, and one that I thoroughly enjoyed. The undoubted star of Asteroid City, as far as I'm concerned, is of course the train within the play, within the TV show, within the film. This brilliant piece of work is a large-scale model. The Arid Plains Railroad is the creation of the prop and model maker Berlin, headed by experienced model maker Simon Weiser. The distinctive orange F7 along with its B unit and train are built to 1/8 scale, small enough to easily work with but big enough to mount cameras on. Propulsion was a mixture of a geared drivetrain as seen here, and the time-honoured method of someone absolutely legging it with the train on a rope. Note the special effects such as the leaf blower to give the impression of dust being whipped up by the train, and the smoke generator within the loco. These are works of art, and Jago Hazard has previously pointed out that the loads carried by this mixed freight helped to set the scene for the film by reflecting the hype of the 1950s. America was a mass producer of food, construction materials and farming equipment. The rising standards of living meant that beautiful automobiles like these Pontiacs were prized possessions, and yet the presence of a nuclear warhead in the train is a reminder of the Cold War era paranoia and the threat of large-scale conflict. The model team also built several near-O-scale sets for the intro sequence. My guess here is that the train in these shots is digitally composited in, judging by the way it doesn't really move within the shot. Here you can see the camera on a dolly capturing the background plates for the sequence. The main railway line also serves as a way to bring protesters and crowds into the Asteroid City outskirts as seen here. Whilst the main train in the intro is a model, the rear of the consist was recreated in 1:1 scale along with a full-size carriage for the Asteroid City Alien Special. This also features right at the end of the intro as the train disappears off set. This film was shot in Spain, the background elements all being one-sided to reinforce the idea that what we're seeing is a stage play. However, I'm not sure if the railway line was later standard or Iberian gauge, although it does look quite wide. Clearly the film embraces the spirit of model railways, as instead of detouring round this rock, the train dives into a tunnel to conveniently take it off scene. As can be seen here, the motive power was an adapted dumper truck. Another train appears in Asteroid City. The Apache Plains Liner is part of the television show and serves as a meeting place for some of the actors playing the characters of Asteroid City, making them fictional characters. Well, actually, the actors in the TV show are playing other actors who starred in the play, so maybe they're actually fictional characters. There is a nice little nod to the Brothers Whitman's attempts to catch the Darjeeling Limited as the Apache Plains Liner pulls away from the station and the understudy is shown running after it. This train, like everything in the TV broadcast, is an obvious set, and the characters do look straight at the audience. What's quite nice from a train point of view is that in the final shot of the film, as all the characters leave stage, the train makes a final appearance, but heading in the opposite direction to all the other shots in the film. Is it off to uncover a new adventure? Who knows what the future holds? I hope you've enjoyed this look at some of my favourite things in my favourite films, and it's been sufficiently entertaining. If so, let me know in the comments, or if you want to point one out that I've missed and give me sleepless nights, that's fine too. Thanks very much for watching, and bye for now.